I would like to begin with the first item on the agenda, report of the executive director, and I'd like to call on Dr. Baker to come forward to make that presentation, please.
Greetings, fellow companions in zealous research. I feel extremely privileged today to address this, the anniversary of our 125th founding. Of course, 125 years ago, this was the Society of the Sigma Xi. Of course, the Sigma Xi refers to the first two letters of our motto, Companions in Zealous Research. I do feel very privileged to address this group. This is my fourth message that I've given as the executive director of this society. I'm very proud to be a member of this society and have been for over 20 years. But in this audience, I know we have one who has been a member for more than 60 years, Mimi Goldschmidt. We have 15 members here who have been a member for 50 or more years. We have 20 who have been a member for 40 or more years, and 39 who are in the category of 20 or more. That's quite an accomplishment, I think, to have that breadth of knowledge represented here at this meeting. I think it's been a wonderful meeting so far, and I'm still looking forward to a lot more discussion from each of you. This is really a wonderful opportunity for us to engage in dialogue to find the next 125 years path. It says, let them join heart and hand, forming a brotherhood in science and engineering. That was printed in the first constitution. Just after that was the statement, and in collegiate halls to award honor, which signifies to the scientific recipients, which shall signify, come up higher. So for 125 years, we have been focused on coming up higher, holding ourselves as recipients of this honor of membership to a higher standard. This past year, the staff and I have had a wonderful time working on this year's meeting and the theme of ethics, integrity, and character in research in science and engineering. Going back 125 years, you're probably wondering, why am I wearing this outfit? Well, I'd ask you to go back, and what did professors wear 125 years ago at Cornell? Academical dress. They went to class in a robe. I don't really wear the hat, but I didn't want to leave it back there and have it get lost. I borrowed it. But, you know, it's really a wonderful occasion to think about. You go back, as was in Dr. Crosby's report, the World Wars, the Great Depression, a number of other things. 50th anniversary in 1936, we were really in the middle of a depression. Or we hadn't recovered from that depression yet that started in 1929. At this particular picture, I was thinking the three people on the left in that picture signed the first charter for Sigma Xi. The individual on the right was the president at the time in 1936. We have people, as I mentioned just a minute ago, that have been 60, 50, 40 years. There's a very proud tradition that we carry forward in this society. But obviously, there are also a few issues. At one time, we had close to 120,000 active dues-paying members. I didn't show the entire timeline of membership for Sigma Xi, but I started back where we were still growing. And from that point, we reached our peak, and it's been a slow decline. I purposely chose these two pictures for the following reason. First of all, the upper right shows young scientists, some of them still in the classroom. This is the future of Sigma Xi, the next generation of scientists and engineers. We need to make sure that we award them the honor that we've received as being a member of Sigma Xi. The picture on the lower right represents a caution to each of us. Those are silhouettes. Those are people who were members but have lapsed in their dues. I have only a few data slides to show you. This first one is the number of new members inducted in fiscal year 1996. So these would have been the 5,600 approximately new members inducted prior to June 30th of 1996. By June 30th of 1998, there was only 2,400 still paying dues. Not too bad. Well, not too good either. So what happened most recently? These are the students and other members that were inducted in FY 2009. A few less than what was inducted a few years earlier, but still a very respectable number. But the retention just 2 years later was less than 25%. Well, you might ask, what is the retention overall in from 2009 to 2011? Now, I should point out, this does not include life members. Obviously, life members have finished paying their dues. These are individuals who are not life members and who should pay dues annually. If you look at the end of FY09, June 30th of 2009, this is the total number of members that had paid dues. By June 30th, 2011, just a couple months ago, 70% of those had paid dues. So I look at this and I say, you know, 70% still is not real good, but it's certainly better than 20, 25%. But the issue is, we are an aging society. The average age of membership in Sigma Xi is in the high 50s. Dr. T.T. Holm was executive director for 28 years. Many of you probably knew him. I just by chance picked up an old issue of American Scientist. I guess serendipity was involved, because I found some just wonderful quotes from him, and some of those are printed in your program book in my letter to you. But one of the questions he asked in 1970, is Sigma Xi in danger of becoming obsolete? It was a couple years later that I was looking at an article that he had put in the magazine, and he asked the question, are we becoming too large? So at one time, we had some concern about that, and I asked myself, well, possibly in the 70s, we had no electronic databases. Everything was done by hand. I don't know how large the staff was, but it might have been a real chore to try to assemble all those dues renewals and collections and process all of those payments. But the other thought I had was, he made another statement. We are not and cannot be a mutual admiration society. So I don't really know the meaning behind his question, are we becoming too large? It might have been the paperwork issue. It might have been this statement that was in the 1981 issue of American Scientist, where he was saying, you know, we can't just let everyone in. It's no longer an honor society if it's simply a mutual admiration society. We must innovate and change to meet this next generation. Today's youth are not used to academical dress. T-shirts, blue jeans, tennis shoes, shorts, sandals, something like that. Now, what has not changed about me from taking off the robe to this? It's still me. It's still my core. And that's the message I also want you to think about for Sigma Xi. I don't want to change in any way the core mission, nor do I think any of you want to change our core. I'm not talking about changing the core and being innovative. I'm talking about how we do what we do to serve the next generation of scientists and engineers. In April of this year, the Board of Directors reaffirmed what's in our Constitution, that we want to be an honor society. This statement that's below that is from a group of three other honor societies that I'm working with right now to put together a white paper on the merits and value of honor societies still in today's colleges and universities. We must continue to reward extraordinary achievements, but to do it for those who have demonstrated character, integrity, and ethics. Membership value proposition for Sigma Xi. The society and the chapter projects must promote and encourage the highest standards and conduct in science and engineering research. I think we need to celebrate excellence by recognizing integrity, ethics, and high achievement. I think chapters and individual members together determine our value of membership. We have had what I consider to be just some outstanding presentations today so far. I'm looking forward to those yet tomorrow. What is the cost of research misconduct? You have probably all seen these headlines in the last 2 to 3 weeks. It is not just the cost to the individual that got caught. It hurts each and every one of us in this room. It hurts our profession. In one of those cases, 14 PhD dissertations are tainted. Think about those 14 students whose entire career now might be ruined because they did a dissertation on fabricated data. The one up there also about the German courts have affirmed that the university has the right to revoke a PhD degree if that individual that received the degree from that institution brings dishonor to it. Over on the lower right, the Wall Street Journal, Mistakes in Scientific Studies Surge. If you've not seen this, we go back, I think if you just Google that. It was actually also in the Science Writers Fall issue. But it really shows some interesting graphs that were also mentioned earlier today about the increase in the number of manuscripts being retracted, both by the journal as well as by the authors. What are we to do about that? Well, many colleges and universities have programs, responsible conduct research programs and others. Some universities have peer review and authorship kinds of training programs for their faculty and students. I thought the one there was to encourage ethical behavior by graduate advisors. There's three scholars that are calling for detailed codes of conduct. The book will be published, I think, by Johns Hopkins University in December. Well, that's one thing. We've got to read the book. And that's fine, we can do that. The next one is, there are a number of ethics courses being offered. This one, I think, is VPI or somewhere in Virginia. And that's fine, too. But I think Sigma Xi can also do its part. Our chapters can help reinforce ethical conduct of research. We can help and advise our students and our colleagues. Make a difference. I think that's what Sigma Xi, the Scientific Research Society, can do and must do. And I think each of you and I have an incentive to do so. It is our profession. It's one that some of us have toiled in for many, many years. I'm a lapsed scientist, I'm sorry. I'll have to pay my dues again someday. But many of you are still very active in the field. You're still very active in training graduate students, teaching undergraduates, and mentoring. One of the things that I found a little bit alarming in the last few months as I visited with students. I've actually focused on trying to visit with our student members the last few months, not that you aren't interesting to talk to, but I was trying to find out from them what Sigma Xi could do to be of more value to them. But one that I found somewhat alarming is a student says, how can I get rid of an advisor? The advisor was not doing her a very good job. And I said, can you find a mentor? Well, isn't that my advisor? I said, no, a mentor does not have to be an advisor at all. It may not even be someone in your field. I was very fortunate that I had a mentor and an advisor that was the same person. Maybe you also had that experience, and if so, I think you should be very, feel a lot of gratitude for that. But I thought this Winston Churchill quote, given that this is Veterans Day, and of course Winston Churchill was, you know, involved in one of those wars that we like to forget, but as a pessimist sees the difficulty in every opportunity, an optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty. And then another quote that I like from Dr. Holm is, we must search for a new and improved method of meeting and accepting the challenges before us. And just to be complete, I thought I'd put a quote from myself in there. I just made this up a day or two ago. But I think there are numerous opportunities that each and every one of us have every day to make a difference and improve the human condition. You saw, or hopefully will see, if you haven't already, the paper that's in this issue of American Scientist. Dr. Lynn Elfner was the lead author on that. He had several others that worked with him. But the board has also reaffirmed that we are a society which values collaboration across many different fields. And that Team Science tip-in paper that's in the magazine is one example that we're sort of saying that we will continue to find ways to collaborate across disciplines. We pledge, I think, as the staff and you, to recognize today's accomplishments and tomorrow's potential, foster creative perspectives within a cross-disciplinary community, achieve greater impact through a culture of collaboration, and guide the responsible practice of science and communicate the discovery to the public. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Well, thank you, Dr. Baker.